Before I speak properly of the contents of the missing part of the third secret, you've been told today that there is no part of the third secret that's missing. And, of course, others are dealing with that in a much more detailed manner. What I would like to point out, however, in that regard, is that if Cardinal Bertone was telling the truth when he said there is no so-called fourth secret, there is no part of the third secret that is missing, no text missing, then various other individuals would necessarily have not been telling the truth if Bertone had indeed been telling the truth. Father Josef Schweigel in 1952, on the 2nd of September, met with Sister Lucy in Coimbra. He was sent by Pope Pius XII. He came back to Rome. He was living at the Rusicum, and he reported to his confreres at the Rusicum that the third secret is in two parts. One part deals with the Pope, and as we know, that portion of the third secret that deals with the Pope was revealed on the 26th of June 2000. Father Schweigel said there is another part of the third secret, but he could not divulge the contents. But he did say, logically, it is the text that follows the et cetera. When Sister Lucy wrote in the third secret, in Portugal, the dogma of the faith will always be preserved, et cetera. Then there was the statement made by Cardinal Ratzinger. Cardinal Ratzinger in 1984 gave an interview that was published in November of 1984. And it was a very revealing comment made to Vittorio Messori in the interview, because he said that the third secret deals with the dangers to the faith and the life of the Christian, and therefore of the whole world. In that portion of the secret that was revealed on the 26th of June 2000, there is nothing there about the dangers to the faith. We can recall that the then Bishop of Liria Fatima, Bishop Cosme do Amaral, made a statement, I believe in 1981, at the Technical University of Vienna, declaring that the third secret of Fatima deals with the issue of the loss of faith. And he made reference to the loss of faith on entire continents. Now, this is very, very revealing when we connect it with this pronouncement of Cardinal Ratzinger. Because when Cardinal Ratzinger spoke of the dangers to the faith and the life of the Christian, he referred to other Marian apparitions, and he referred to the sacred scripture. That what is in the third secret corresponds to scripture. It corresponds to what has been mentioned again and again in many other Marian apparitions. In referring to the scripture, he specifies the eschatological texts of scripture. When he used that phrase in Italian, I novissimi. Some have rather disingenuously tried to argue that, well, when we speak of the last things, we're talking about death, judgment, heaven, and hell, the four last things. But that is not possibly what Cardinal Ratzinger was talking about. That is not possibly what Our Lady was talking about. If we want to learn about the four last things, we need only to consult the Catechism. It is very clearly set forth there. Our Lady did not come down from heaven to impart a simple catechism lesson. When the Cardinal spoke of the last things, he's referring to what the prophet Daniel said would take place in the end. He was referring to the end times. The last things, as we would say in Greek, eschata, the eschatological things, the eschatological texts of Scripture. This is the third secret. And there again we come to the question of the loss of faith. St. Paul, in his second letter to the Thessalonians, speaks of the great apostasy. And this great apostasy must take place before the appearance of the son of perdition, the man of sin. In a single word, the Antichrist. St. Paul, in that text, says, the mystery of iniquity is already operating among us. And if you were to make a careful study of world history and specifically of the history of the church, we can trace century by century, age by age, the continuous unfolding of the mystery of iniquity. And that mystery of iniquity reaches its culmination in that which is foretold in the secret of Fatima, and most specifically, that which is revealed in the not yet published text of the third secret of Fatima. It is for this reason that Pope John Paul II, speaking about the third secret, said he was not willing to reveal the third secret because he thought there was a danger of sensationalism. On another occasion, Cardinal Ratzinger used that same word in connection with the third secret. There was the problem of sensationalism. If we consider what has already been said by the most credible authorities about the third secret of Fatima, we know, if not in details, we know specifically what is revealed there in the third secret. And that is what I will be speaking about today. Getting more deeply into the mystery of iniquity, insofar as that is revealed in the third secret of Fatima, I will be speaking about on that topic on Friday. And so today I'm going to deal with the contents of the third secret, and I will make an assessment, the parallels that we see in Catholic prophecy, in the approved Marian apparitions, the messages of Our Lady, sacred scripture, in the eschatological texts of sacred scripture, and contemporary geopolitical developments, which serve for us as the signs of the times foretold in prophetic messages and in sacred scripture. So we will know just how close we are to the fulfillment of these events foretold in Scripture and in the Marian apparitions. Cardinal Ratzinger told Howard D., who was then at that time, some years ago, the ambassador of the Philippines to the Holy See, that the secret of Fatima corresponds to what is revealed by Our Lady in the message of Akita in Japan. There, Our Lady foretold a great chastisement that would be worse than the great deluge, the flood that is spoken of in the book of Genesis. Now that is something that would be truly sensational, a chastisement that is worse than the flood. And if we should consult other prophetic messages and texts, we can specifically enumerate some of the things that will take place in this great chastisement, this great tribulation foretold in Scripture and down through the ages by the saints and in the messages of the revelations made by Our Lady in her approved apparitions. Let it suffice to say that when Cardinal Bertone tells us that there is no part of the third secret that has not yet been divulged, well, let us consider for a moment the credibility, or lack thereof, the lack of credibility of Cardinal Bertone. He came out with a statement on the 26th of June 2000, saying that with the revelation of the secret, the period of history marked by the lust for power and evil has come to an end. Now, were it not such a pathetically false statement, I would call it comical. Not that I will accuse a cardinal of the Roman Church of being a comedian. That would be not suit his dignity as a prince of the church. But I will say such comments would be far more appropriate for late night television entertainment than for a Vatican press conference where one is expected to deal seriously with such issues as the secret of Fatima. There is definitely a problem of credibility, because then if it were true what Cardinal Bertone has said about the third secret, then Cardinal Ratzinger was not telling the truth when he spoke of the eschatological text of Scripture, the Novissimi, the dangers to the faith that are in the third secret as spoken of by Cardinal Ratzinger, and the loss of faith as spoken by Bishop Cosme do Amaral. We see none of that in that portion of the secret that was revealed on June 26th of 2000. In Cardinal Bertone's mouthpiece, Giuseppe De Cardi, I think charitably the most I can say about his outbursts is, if he was not deliberately lying, well, himself deceived, he deceives others. Because if De Cardi is telling the truth, if Cardinal Bertone is telling the truth, then would we say that the man personally sent by Pope Pius XII to interview Sister Lucy about the third secret was inventing? Did Father Josef Schweigel, the personal emissary of Pius XII, lie and make an invention? Did he fabricate the story that the third secret is divided into two parts, one part that deals with the Pope and the other the words following that phrase in Portugal, the dogma of the faith will always be preserved, etc.? Who's lying? Who is telling the truth? I think it is quite evident that Cardinal Ratzinger was not making an invention, that Father Josef Schweikel was not making an invention, that Pope John Paul II in Fulda was not making an invention when he said that in the third secret it is revealed that the oceans would vaporize and millions would die from 1 minute to the next. Now, there are some who deny that the Pope ever made that statement, but I happen to have lived in Fulda for some time, back in the early 80s. And I know that when the Pope gave his discourse to some German pilgrims at the crypt of the Cathedral of Fulda, he was asked a question about the third secret, and he gave his answer. And one of the reasons why he mentioned that he said that he was not revealing the third secret, because he said he did not want to reveal the secret because this would might encourage the communists to take certain steps. So there is something in the third secret that would at least give the appearance, the impression, that there would be something that would give the communists encouragement to take certain steps. Well, we know from other Marian apparitions and from other very credible prophecies exactly what it is that Pope John Paul II was referring to when he made that remark. A German priest, a Father Bonifacius, wrote down the transcript of the Pope's comment on the third secret, and a journalist published her own transcript in a German publication. I read the text both, the published text and the handwritten text of Father Bonifacius was presented to me when I was in Fulda. And there is complete and total agreement between both versions. Father Bonifacius and the German journalists certainly were not inventing the words and putting them into the mouth of Pope John Paul II. If Cardinal Bertone is telling the truth, then all of these people were lying. Pope John Paul II, Cardinal Ratzinger, Father Schweigel. I find it much more believable that only one man is lying. And I will leave it at that. Definitely there is a portion of the secret that has not been revealed. And there are not too many people who believe what Cardinal Bertone has said, saying that the entire secret has been published and there is nothing left. There has been the statement made by Archbishop Capovilla, who on one occasion has told one story, and on another occasion says there's no more to it, there's no more to the secret than what has been published. My question to Archbishop Capovilla is that both versions cannot be true. Was he telling the truth when he talked with Sordo Pallini? Or is he telling the truth now? I should like to hear the answer to that question. The third secret of Fatima, I think it was summed up best by Malachy Martin. The late Malachy Martin worked in the Vatican. He studied at the Biblicum. He was a vastly learned man. He wrote works of fiction, but not only fiction. You'll see some of his works were nonfiction. The Jesuits, for example. He wrote a book with the startling title, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Church. Here we're already getting into something of the third secret. Not that the church will be defeated totally and entirely, but it is foretold in Scripture in the book of Lamentations, where we read, "For all the kings of the earth and all the peoples of the world could not believe that the adversary and the enemy had entered into the gates of Jerusalem." This text is sadly fulfilled already in our times. And in the third secret, we will see the culmination of this mystery of iniquity. The late Monsignor Mario Marini worked nearly 40 years in the Vatican before he died last year, nearly a year ago. It was in May of last year. He was a personal friend of mine. I knew him for 35 years. In 1996, Monsignor Marini told me when I was visiting Rome, speaking of the Roman Curia, he said, and he made this gesture, "Our hands are tied. We can do nothing because it is Masons who occupy the key positions." The last time I saw him before he died, in October 2008, Monsignor Marini told me, "We are under Masonic occupation." How high in the church is the Masonic occupation? Monsignor Marini said, "Key positions are occupied by Masons." Perhaps this would explain why you have the text of the Syllabus of Errors of Pope Pius IX, which is a solemn condemnation, solemn and definitive. You look in paragraph number 6, it conforms to the criteria stated in the 1983 Code of Canon Law for an infallible pronouncement that is not quite as solemn as the dogmatic definition, but solemn, sufficiently solemn and definitive that it bears the theological note of infallibility. And we see the condemnation of the doctrine of religious liberty, almost verbatim, almost exactly as that doctrine is set forth as a truth in the Second Vatican Council text. A reversal of doctrine. Yet we hear so many times, again and again and again, they will tell us that in the Second Vatican Council we don't have anything that contradicts dogma, we don't have anything that contradicts the doctrine of the faith, but it must be interpreted according to tradition. Well, that is like taking the 95 Theses of Martin Luther and saying, well, there's no heresy there, but we've got to interpret it according to tradition. The statement is absurd. I won't go too deeply into this because I've already written about this in my book, The Suicide of Altering the Faith in a Liturgy, where the entire history of the church, the tradition of the church and sacred scripture are utterly incompatible with the teaching of religious liberty, and ecumenism as set forth in Vatican II. And so we have the tradition and scripture, both. We have the most forceful condemnation of ecumenism made by Pope Pius XI in his encyclical letter, Mortalium Animos. And he said that ecumenism, the error of ecumenism is such that it would destroy the church to its very foundations. Yet, since Vatican II, we are told that the church has an irrevocable commitment to ecumenism for the sake of unity. This is truly the diabolical disorientation of the third secret of Fatima. Sister Lucy referred to the diabolical disorientation in the church's hierarchy at the very highest levels. We look in the encyclical letter of Pope John Paul II, Ut Unum Sint, and we see that the disorientation was at the very highest level. The disorientation inhabited the mind of the Vicar of Christ on earth, Pope John Paul II. He is the one who declared that the church has an irrevocable commitment to ecumenism. The problem there is that ecumenism is the greatest threat to the church. Ecumenism was created by the greatest, most mortal enemies of the church for the purpose of destroying the church. Ecumenism is the greatest obstacle to unity. And yet, we are told that we must promote ecumenism for the sake of unity. To understand just how absurd is the idea that ecumenism promotes unity, we need only to consider what are the bonds of communion. In what does unity consist? There are the three bonds of unity. The bond of faith. The bond of the sacraments. And the bond of ecclesiastical governance. In the formulation of St. Paul, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. There is one faith, the Catholic faith, outside of which there is no salvation. Or as the First Vatican Council stated, outside of that faith, there is no salvation. There is one religion, which is a divine institution. That is the Catholic religion. No other religion on earth is a divine institution. This is why there is no salvation outside of the Catholic faith, because it is the divine and Catholic faith. Mere human doctrines cannot gain salvation. They do not have the power to confer grace. It is through faith and the sacraments, by the supernatural power of God, through faith in the grace that we receive from Almighty God in the sacraments, that brings about salvation. And so there cannot be communion between the church and any other religion. So there is the bond of faith, the bond of the sacraments, and ecclesiastical governance. Where there are these three bonds of communion, there is unity. Ecumenism is, as Pope John Paul II himself declared in Ut Unum Sint, ecumenism had its origin in the churches of the Reform, the Protestants. We can go back further, and we will see that ecumenism, before it invaded the church, and before it invaded the Protestant denominations, was first promoted by Freemasonry. It is of Jewish origin. The idea of natural religion as the vehicle of salvation for the Gentiles, this was the teaching of the Jewish rabbis. And the Jewish philosopher Mendelssohn, the grandfather of the composer Felix Mendelssohn, wrote this, and I provide the precise quotation of the text in my book, The Suicide of Altering the Faith in the Liturgy. Now we can begin to grasp what the third secret is dealing with, a great apostasy and loss of faith, and what will bring that about. Because the unity that will be created by ecumenism is the unity sought after for centuries by Freemasonry. It is Freemasonry that would set up in the world a one world religion, with this Jewish Protestant idea of unity. The idea that all the Christian denominations can coexist in peace and harmony and unity is absolutely incompatible with the Catholic faith, the doctrine of unity, the bonds of communion. It is coherent strictly and entirely logically in the absurd notion of Protestantism that there can be communion in doctrinal diversity. So what unity will ecumenism bring? It will not bring unity in Christ, but what Pope St. Pius X warned about in his 1904 encyclical, when he warned about the coming one world religion. This is the great danger to the faith and the life of the Christian that Cardinal Ratzinger was speaking about. This is the great apostasy that Bishop Cosme de Amaral was speaking about, referring to the loss of faith. This is the content of the third secret that has not been revealed. Bishop Cosme de Amaral was so impressed by this great spiritual tribulation, the greatest and worst persecution of the church that there ever will have been or ever will be. And this is what Pope Pius XII was speaking of. Just after the end of the Second World War, when he said in one of his discourses, mankind must soon undergo such suffering such as the world has never seen before. The coming persecution, the coming tribulation, will be worse than the Great Flood, and the persecution will be worse than the ancient Roman persecutions. Our Lady specifically spoke of Russia, and to the contemporary mind, which has been fed such a superficial understanding of geopolitical realities, that it seems hard to grasp How could Russia play a role in something so horrendous, something so terrible, that is about to erupt in the world? And make no mistake, the time is now very, very close. In order to understand how close we are to a world war, a war between Russia and the West, I should like to point out, as in the first edition of The Devil's Final Battle, as in the revised one, you open the cover, and there you will see the World Trade Center towers burning shortly before they collapsed. The original idea for inserting this into the, this photograph into the book was simply to show that what Cardinal Bertone was saying about the end of the period of lust for power and evil in the world is already finished, that this is ridiculous, it is absurd. But there is a deeper connection that I did not understand when we first, I and my co-authors first decided on putting that photograph into the book. There is a much more intimate connection between international terrorism and how it is directly leading us into the great clash of the superpowers between Russia and the United States and their allies. I was talking to an archbishop in the Vatican last year, and when I pointed out how close we are to the next world war breaking out, he could not grasp it. Many bishops I've spoken with have no difficulty grasping it, and they understand exactly why. But you would have thought, by the archbishop's comments and the look on his face, you would have thought that I had said something to the effect that Vladimir Putin is a space alien who's got secret armies on the dark side of the moon. Similarly, 5 years ago, I spoke to a man in Germany and pointed out that the time for the next world war is closing in on us. It will be happening soon. Well, he answered to me, "No, no, that can't be. Russia and the West are partners. They're friends. Look," he said, "Putin and Chancellor Schröder, they're friends." Well, Putin and George Bush profess to be friends. But the interesting thing, when President Putin warned his friend, George W. Bush, that there was going to be a terrorist attack on the United States, that they would be using airplanes, George Bush paid no attention to the warning. And then after the attack, George Bush lied to the whole world, and he said nobody in the government could have any idea that terrorists were going to use planes as a weapon. If you understand who really was behind that attack and the attacks in London on July 7, 2005, then you will be able to decipher the message of President Dmitry Medvedev when he spoke of the attacks, the bombings made in the Moscow subway, and the subsequent bombings, the attacks on Russia. As one of the Russian government experts on terrorism said, these attacks are an act of war against all of Russia. President Medvedev, in a recent speech, said these attacks were organized by a North Caucasus Islamic group that is linked with that organization known as Al-Qaeda. If we understand the origin of Al-Qaeda, we'll understand we're not dealing with an independent group of terrorists, but we are dealing with covert false flag operations of one state against another. Now we can begin to understand how close we are to the next world war. And what is most frightful? I will say this. We know from Catholic prophecy the next war will be brief. That's the good news. There will be a world war. That's the good news. The bad news is what happens after. In the prophecy of Zachary, the Armenian Jew who converted to the Catholic faith, published in 1854, the edited text of the prophecy, the revelations that he received from God, Father Fatacelli compiled the prophecies and published them in a book called Day of Anger, The Hand of God Upon an Empire. That empire is described in its geographical dimensions as occupying the space of what is the Soviet Union and China. That is the empire that will use great guile and deception, as we had in the period of detente and the glasnost and perestroika of Gorbachev before the scheduled demolition of the Soviet Union. And then there would be the war that the prophecy refers to as the struggle of the strong against the strong. This empire of the North, consisting of Russia and China and North America, will go to war. And this 19th century text says they will fire their missiles on North America. And North America will fall and be conquered and brought into bondage. The next phrase is the most frightful thing of all. It is then that Zachary says in this text published in 1854, and then the whole world fell under the dominion of the firstborn of hell. This is the third secret. How close are we now to the great war that will usher in the godless empire, the one world religion of Masonry? Let's examine a prediction made, which is not a prophecy, but a prediction. An interview was published on the 16th of January, 1962, in Look magazine, an interview given by David Ben-Gurion, the sitting Prime Minister of Israel. You can go to a search engine and very easily find the text, the photograph of the page of Look magazine. I mention this because about 20 years ago, on a radio program, I spoke of this interview. And the B'nai B'rith Association, the Anti-Defamation League, accused me of fabricating the text, and that Ben-Gurion, they said, never made this statement. So I told the owner of the radio station, well, if you want to know the truth of the matter, Look magazine, 16th of January, 1962. I said no more. I didn't need to say anymore. And when you make the quotation, see, the Anti-Defamation League presents itself as a Jewish organization, and they say, well, this priest is anti-Jewish, anti-Semitic. It is out of hatred for the Jews that he's saying this. But the Anti-Defamation League is not Jewish. It is part of the B'nai B'rith Masonic Lodge, the Masonic Association. It calls itself by a Hebrew name, Sons of the Covenant. But they're no more Jewish than the priests of Baal who were slaughtered by the prophet Isaiah. The prophet Elijah. The prophet Elijah, he was the Jew, not the pagan priests that he slew. I mention that because in spite of all the Jewish sounding name, B'nai B'rith, it is Masonic. Now it's a very simple matter. There have been books written asking the question, trying to answer the question, what is a Jew? Well, I think what is fundamental, that a Jew is a person who worships the God of the Jews. A pagan is a person who worships the gods of the pagans. B'nai B'rith is Masonic. It is pagan. It worships the gods of the pagans. It worships the gods. It worships the God that was worshipped by the priests of Baal, who were slaughtered by the Jewish prophet Elijah. So when I point the finger at Masonry, it is not out of hatred for the Jews, but it is out of hatred, as Scripture says of the Christ, you have loved what is right and you have hated iniquity. It is out of hatred of the diabolical iniquity, of the worship of demons, of the false gods of the pagans. That is truly something worthy of hatred. Masonry is a detestable, diabolical institution. It merits only to be hated, to be opposed, and destroyed. Pope Leo XIII said that Masonry must be defeated. It is not an institution that we can seek ecumenical friendship with. It is an organization that must be uprooted and wiped off the face of the earth. And the hand of God is going to wipe Masonry off the face of the earth in the great chastisement. And in the time of triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, there will no longer be the devilish institution of Freemasonry. And so, the text of that interview of David Ben-Gurion, who was not speaking as a mouthpiece of the Jewish people or the Jewish religion or the Israeli nation. Rather, he is speaking as a mouthpiece of Masonry. When he stated in 1962 how the world will change in about 25 years. Very interesting, he places the context at the end of the Cold War, when the Cold War will end. This is very, very interesting. We can see that there was already the plans to end the Cold War in the manner that it was ended. In fact, 25 years later, 1987, exactly 25 years later, there was that well-known speech of President Gorbachev to the Communist Party when he said, "Gentlemen, comrades, don't be alarmed by all this talk of perestroika, glasnost, and the coming democracy in the Soviet Union." 4 years later, that democracy came. Gorbachev told the Communist Party, "Don't be afraid of this. don't be alarmed by this. He said that in 1987. He said, this is only cosmetic. These changes will only be cosmetic. It is to lull the Americans to sleep. 1984, Anatoly Golitsyn published a book foretelling the restructuring of the Soviet Union that Gorbachev undertook, which brought about the transformation of the Soviet Union into the Russian Federation and the Commonwealth of Independent States. In the Club of Rome, founded with the money of David Rockefeller, the globalists who worked together for that institution that they refer to as global governance, what David Rockefeller calls one world, and in his autobiography says he's working for the one world government. Around 1973, in their papers, you read that after the end of the Cold War, we need to have something that will frighten all the people of the world. There will be a unanimous fear that we can use to impose a world government on the people of the world. And that will be this thing that we call global warming, climate change. So last December at the Copenhagen conference, they're talking about the imposition of global carbon taxes, a crushing burden of taxation that will rob the working classes, especially in the poorer classes, of the money that they need to survive, to buy food and to provide for their basic needs. That will be taxed away from them. And on the other hand, the policy using carbon credits and such to de-industrialize the world, decrease production. What you're going to create is artificial shortages this way. And they're going to tell us that the problem is that we have too many people. Whereas it's not that there are too many people, it's not that the world is overpopulated, but they have artificially engineered by design the economic crises that will culminate, according to their plan, in the year 2012. At the Wilderness Conference in Colorado, 1987, under the auspices of the United Nations, this convention was discussing taking developed land, farmland and developed land, and turning it back into wilderness. Deindustrialization. And they were discussing this in 1987. And at that conference, Edmund the Rothschild was there, David Rockefeller was there, the Rothschild frontman, Morris Strong, was there, and they let it be known that they were planning for a global financial crisis. And that will culminate in the year 2012, and then they will foist on the world a global central bank. There'll be one central bank for the whole world. Last year at the G20 meeting, you may recall that President Medvedev held up a coin announcing the coming of this global unit of currency. And Prime Minister Putin advocated the creation of a global central bank. So all of these people are talking about these things, and they, as in the Club of Rome in the early 70s, as Gorbachev foretold in 1987, the end of the Cold War, coming democracy in the Soviet Union, David Ben-Gurion, the Prime Minister of Israel, in January of 1962 spoke of these changes that will take place after the end of the Cold War. He said that America will by then have become a welfare state with a planned economy. In one word, that's a euphemistic phrase to describe socialism. Is the United States now becoming socialist? It certainly looks that way with the policies being instituted by President Obama. And that's not just my opinion. I was watching on Russia Today last September an interview with Mikhail Gorbachev. And Gorbachev stated that under President Obama, that the United States is now undergoing its own perestroika, its own restructuring. David Ben-Gurion foretold this in 1962 in that interview. Then he said, Europe will become a federated state, democratic and socialist in character. Not socialist like the Soviet Union, collectivism, but the kind of socialism that you had under National Socialism in Germany, but without all the racial Germanic propaganda of the Nazi movement. We now are under a very undemocratic, one might say, bureaucratic dictatorship, like the directorate dictatorship of the French Revolution, imposed on all of the member states of the European Union from Brussels, the fulfillment of what was foretold by David Ben-Gurion. Gorbachev called the European Union the new European Soviet. And it is described very well by Christopher Story in his book, The European Union Collective, Enemy of Its Member States. And with the institution of taxation, the kind of taxation that was recommended at the Copenhagen Conference supposedly for climate change, but where they announced the need for global governance. And the conference was really concerned with setting up the institutional framework for global governance, which is to say for world government. And climate change is only an excuse to make this appear necessary. And they say that the ultimate remedy is not carbon taxation and reducing carbon footprints, but drastic reduction of population. Europe has become exactly what David Ben-Gurion foretold would take place at the end of the Cold War. Once the Cold War is over, you will see the United States become socialist, you will see Europe become a united federated state. That's a reality, it has happened. Then he said, the Soviet Union by then will have become a federated Eurasian state. How many people could have dreamed that one day the Soviet Union would be instantaneously transformed into a commonwealth, a federal union of independent states? Ben-Gurion foretold this in 1962. So what happens after that? When the United States becomes socialist, when Europe becomes a federated state, When the Soviet Union becomes a federated Eurasian state, all these things have happened. What is the next thing that happens? Ben-Gurion says there will be the World Federation of Continents. That's the world government. That is the world government that has been promoted by Masonry openly since the 1730s. It is their published agenda to establish in the world the New World Order, the One World Masonic Republic. This is what Ben-Gurion is talking about when he says there will be the World Federation of Continents. In its headquarters, where will be the Supreme Court of Mankind that will pronounce judgment on all the nations without appeal. That will be located in Jerusalem. And he goes one step further to say, he connects this idea not to secularism. We're not dealing with something Jewish or secular Zionism. We're not dealing with a political doctrine here. He ties it into a belief system. And he blasphemously says that this will be the fulfillment of what was foretold by the prophet Isaiah. Of course, it's blasphemy because the prophet Isaiah was a Jewish prophet. He was not a Mason. Ben-Gurion's religion, like that of the Masons, was described, if I remember correctly, in the 7th chapter, I believe, of the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Described when God told the prophet Ezekiel, showed him the vision of the abomination. The elders of Israel facing toward the rising, worshiping, facing toward the rising of the sun. This is the solar worship of the solar pagan cult of Masonry, for whom the sun is the representation of the pagan deity worshipped by the ancient Canaanites. The Baal worship that was the arch enemy of Almighty God and the Jewish prophets. And this is why St. John tells us in the Apocalypse, chapter 2, verse 9, they say that they are Jews, but they are not Jews. They are the synagogue of Satan. Clearly they are not Jews. There can be no such thing as a Jewish Mason any more than there could be such a thing as a Catholic Mason. It's a contradiction in terms. As Christians, we worship the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. The Jews worship the God of the patriarchs and prophets, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Moses, the God of the prophets, the God of the Old and the New Testament, are one and the same God. So if you're Christian or if you are a Jew, you're defined as Christian or Jew insofar as you worship that God. If you are a Mason, you worship the demon gods of Masonry. And you cannot be called a Christian or a Jew because you don't worship the God of the Christians and the Jews. This is the mystery of iniquity revealed in Scripture. George Bush, Sr., in 1989 said that the New World Order will come into being 11 years in the future, singling out, pointing to the year 2000. St. Paul says, do not despise prophecy, because the coming war and tribulation and the great persecution under the One World Masonic government, this has been told again, foretold again and again. Since the 4th century, we see prophecies of the saints foretelling these things. Century after century, the Blessed Virgin comes down from heaven to warn us precisely about the coming war, as she did in Quito, Ecuador, as she has done again and again, warning us about the tremendous war that will soon take place in the world. So we can look at Fatima and say, oh, but can we believe Sister Lucy? Can we believe this secret? But the secret, as Cardinal Ratzinger said, this has been mentioned again and again in many other Marian apparitions. It corresponds to what is revealed in Scripture. So if we don't believe it, we violate the principle set forth by St. Paul himself in Scripture when he said, do not despise prophecy. God sends prophecy to us. It is a gift to warn us, not to reveal something new, but to warn us what we must do to face the present dangers to our faith and to our lives. And that is what Cardinal Ratzinger was referring to when he said in the third secret of Fatima, it deals with the dangers to the faith in the life of the Christian. It corresponds to sacred scripture, precisely the last things. This is the content of the third secret of Fatima that has not been revealed. I've painted the picture in general. It is far more specific. The phraseology of Our Lady is cut and dry, very much to the point. And it reveals precisely the events, the horrifying, terrible events that are soon to break out in the world. But that is not the end. Because what will happen in the end? Our Lady said, in the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. The Holy Father will consecrate Russia to me. Russia will be converted, and a period of peace will be given to the world.